need each other.
Now, count in your mind 5 seconds, and then I put the timer.
I don't know what to do. Are we to start now? I
mean, one.
Welcome very, very much to Conversation. We have two gentlemen here joining us. We're going to be talking about the human condition in broad general terms, including issues of global warming and other issues that confront humanity now, and the state of humanity in a sense of historical perspective on that existence of that species nested within a larger structure of the universe and large issues such as that. And if I may, on my far left is Ted Hall, and he's involved with Columbia University, and he's very much of an ecologist. And he's here joining, and he's also part of you have a group, you call it the Common or something?
Transformative Communities.
Transformative Communities, you're a member of that, or of the board?
I'm a partner there, yeah.
Right. And also, on my immediate left, a friend of mine from far back, Ted Schulman, who's a partner also of that.
Yes.
And they're here, and we're going to be talking about the human condition and technology and all that sort of thing. So, gentlemen, welcome very, very much for Conversations, right?
Thank you, Harold.
So, the planet's in is, what do you think? Maybe we could let you, Ted, start if we ask you a question or so. You're from another perspective. I'm very old. I'm 82. You're very young, and so you have a youthful perspective on things. Ted's sort of in the middle. But let's start with you and I, and I'd ask you, what is it, how is youth doing? And in terms of your fellow members of that generation, as it were, who do they see? What is the feeling, do you think, among them in terms of the fate of the Earth, to use a loaded term, and the situation of planet Earth at this particular time in the year 2017? Are they upbeat, concerned, worried, enthusiastic? And what are some of the problems that confront them as they think from their perspective of the fate of the world and what might be able to be done to address possibilities for that fate?
Without trying to speak for all of my sort of age range,
yeah, right.
The sense that I get is there's a very powerful awakening conscience and collective unity of everybody, spiritual kind of elevating that occurs that's hard to articulate.
Mm-hmm.
So there's this awakening sense of justice, and then at the same time, when we look at the outer world, our shared kind of material world, there is a lot of confusion.
Confusion.
Because of what I'd say misleading information and confusion, extreme
Why are they
fear.
Doing things that way or something like that?
Well, it
what do they think they're doing? Well, and things could be better.
Many realize that global warming has been put into a runaway situation now.
Yeah.
This
mm-hmm.
this year, it's very visible,
mm-hmm.
with the North Pole being over 50 degrees hotter than usual this year.
No, wait a minute. What, for the year? Or?
For the winter. This winter, the 100,000 square miles of permafrost melted in the winter.
Good grief.
And you could feel it in New York.
Yeah, that's happening in Siberia as well, I think. Yeah, of course it would. Yeah.
So this that's the size of Colorado. So yeah. The state of Colorado, that landmass of the permafrost melted.
Yeah.
And
a lot of release of methane.
Many things.
Yeah.
So this the youth I find who are aware of that are extremely upset and very frustrated with the incompetence of the institutions and government sort of frameworks that have created the problem, and also seem to only be exacerbating the problem.
Why do you think they're operating that way rather than more wisely, as you see clearly available to us? Why have they stuck with ways that are outdated or inappropriate or unnecessary, as maybe they were necessary at one time? Or how? What's the explanation for the lag on the part of the established institutions and people?
I think it's an addiction to divisive discourse.
Really? Okay.
And to an addiction to denying what is possible, because it's a lot easier to cheat and present oneself as succeeding, mm-hmm. but the jig is pretty much up with most of the leading powers of the world. It's the youth are very aware of the fact that that we are in uncharted territory for the species, and are also terribly bankrupt. We're left with a completely bankrupt financial system, so mm-hmm. there's almost no economic leverage to create solutions. And so I think that the established powers that are just not adaptive enough for evolution are, of course, they're going even further in the wrong direction in some cases. And even the most seemingly sensical solutions are actually pretty dangerous in those spaces, mm-hmm. because they're not looking at the whole picture. And so I'd say it's if people would speak with each other instead of crucify the planet for the sake of these imaginary subgroups of political party and racial identity, and we have real history in our ethnic makeup, but the ideas of these groups are actually people are addicted to denying our unity as a species.
Yeah, I suggest you've taken an indictment of the society as it's in place. I would suggest, I'm not sure, it just comes out of my mind, that I think probably over the long haul, what is it, 200,000 years we've been around as a species, 10,000 generations, maybe something like that, that it's always the youth who have that kind of attitude toward the system in place, but you think it's of a new qualitative difference in terms of the distinction between those trying to reify the outdated institutional structures and systems of dealing with the economy and so forth than it has been traditionally between the generations. You think it's uniquely a gap between them, but I think it's probably always, in a certain sense, sometimes laughingly, been there.
Probably, because that's yeah. progress. We're made to progress.
Yeah.
I think it's one of those terms that you know, 6-7 years ago when we started working together.
You too, yeah.
It was around many of these issues and around this incredibly transformative time that we're going through.
Right.
I came up in the 60s and the generation gap was very deep at that point. Now, I think between us, that there's commonality. The 60s was a time of tremendous conflict and change.
I have
two children who are about, you know, the generation ahead of Ted, who are close to 10 years older. And they came up during relatively good times. They came up after the fall of the wall in the Soviet Union, and there was a sense that 80. that society was moving ahead in a positive way.
Yeah.
Now we've hit barriers across the board on the economic system, on the environment. The current system is falling apart. It's transitioning. And I think that the generation gap that we had seen earlier, to some degree, is still there. There's always a generation gap somehow, but
hopefully.
But the depth that was there, I don't think we're seeing that at this stage.
You don't think there's that much depth now as there was then? You mean? Is that what you're saying?
I don't think it's a generational issue. I think it's far more of
a
social development issue, and that a lot of the problems that we're having, especially in this country, are stratified levels of social development. In Middle America, you have the church formalist. And they tend to be ethnocentric. They tend to be looking only at, you know, nationalism and their own closed circle. On the other hand, there are more progressives. Even The modernist, the capitalist, tends to have a world-centric view. And certainly the work that we've been doing together is world-centric. So a major change is on world-centric, but also a major change is happening at all levels, I think, across society now, as we move from an unsustainable system, a deeply pathological and unsustainable system, which is on the verge of destroying certainly humanity and potentially all of life on the planet short term.
I don't think that's possible. All of life.
It's very possible.
Oh, really? I'd like you to spell that out. Or do you have research?
We don't totally agree on that, but it's we agree on the starkness, I think. I would think we agree on the emotional response to it.
All of life, there certainly will be some bacteria and protozoa left, but it will strip it back to that level potentially.
That's a more precious liaison than just humanity coming out of Homo sapiens, Neanderthal, or that kind of thing. But, you know, I think the weapons are sufficient to obliterate the species. I didn't think life could be obliterated. I mean, it'd take another few billion years or something, but that's a more precious miracle, almost. I'd use the term that there was this thing happening on this planet is just an incredible, huge miracle, or an unbelievable miracle, that everything that's gone on this planet, in this universe, occurred. I don't know where. We don't know yet now if it has occurred elsewhere, or what do we think about when we think about the universe and what's out there in terms of our relationship to the broader universe these terms.
It seems that there's a lot of very solid evidence that the whole universe is full of life.
Is that right? Okay.
It's full of ice and microbe, basically invisible life. So the whole universe is this giant ocean of life. So it would definitely, we might be maybe the lamest show in our neck of the woods.
The lamest show. We should get it. instead of an Oscar award.
Not this show, but maybe the meta show.
What would we call it? We'd have to have a statue or something called the lamest.
But it means we can
nice
go up.
That could be part of a poem
we can
or
go
a rock
up.
Song or something. Yeah.
We could certainly, we can certainly do better, which is really cool.
Although I think Donald Trump already has the copyright on the lamest show.
He's sure moving fast now, and everything.
But he can do good if he wants.
To go along with what Ted's saying, the universe itself is a living entity, and that's something that we've been working on as an underlying platform in Transcoms, is to promote that deep paradigm shift. Uh-huh. In Western societies, since the scientific revolution. Yeah. Essentially has looked at matter as the fundamental building blocks of the universe and has ignored consciousness. Leading edge sciences...
Or the mind itself.
And the mind.
Yeah.
and leading edge sciences now have taken this full circle and brought the role of consciousness back into this, and it's we've been involved with and working with a number of scientists, evolutionary scientists group at the United Nations, who are helping to move this shift along. And this is perhaps it's the largest or one of the largest paradigm shifts that's actually occurred in history. We moved from a flat Earth to a round Earth. And to move from a universe that's fundamentally material to an idealistic view, to understanding that consciousness is the primary element, the primacy of consciousness in the universe, redefines our place in it in totality.
Where do we find that being expressed in the modern experience? We've had that kind of thing expressed in many of the religious traditions that wants to do that. But would that be like... John Lovelock, Gaia, the principle of Gaia.
Gaia is part of it.
Where are the things that come out of the scientific revolution
the group
that don't come out of the religious
anthropologists or religious?
Well, no, I was thinking more of the miracle people with religion that has an answer to everything, or even something like Scientology or something like that.
Well, the group that's doing I think the leading research in this area is the Institute of Noetic Sciences.
Oh, right. Yeah, who in the two
is this? They were founded by Edgar Mitchell, who
was an
Apollo astronaut.
And, absolutely. Yeah.
And in his trip had a...
A lot of experiences, I think.
Had an experience of enlightenment, had an understanding. Yeah. And when he came back to Earth, you know, it was clear to him that modern science ignores consciousness and the mind. That he, you know, he came back and essentially understood that modern science would be perfectly happy if consciousness didn't exist.
Yeah, right.
Because consciousness brings you to the hard question. And there's no way to begin to answer that. So most scientists ignore the hard question, but science is now helping us to understand that that's fundamental, and that there is no reality unless it's observed. So our role here is to observe each other and to create this shared reality. I think it was Einstein who said that that reality is an illusion, but a persistent one.
Yeah. Or a dream, even. And we have to co-create the dream, and that's... I can't remember the scientist's name. It goes through the rational proof of the primacy of consciousness, or the primacy of the mind, but if a photon goes at the speed of light, then that means, basically, the moment that a photon is generated... And the moment that it is sort of dissipated or it hits matter, to that photon, it's the same moment, even if it traveled billions of light years. So when we look at a photon of a star, our mind is actually one with that photon. That's just a rational proof. So that means our mind is eternal. So how can something perceive an eternal phenomena without being eternal?
Well, I don't know. You're getting in space I'm not real familiar with and so forth, all those kind of things.
Yeah, that's Peter Russell.
Peter Russell, yeah.
Yeah, I know Peter Russell.
It's a fantastic talk. It's a world-changing talk.
Well, I would suppose there is a lot of that. There's been that kind of thing going on all along with people having, you know, you had L. Ron Hubbard and Scientology, and you had other kinds of things. You had, what was her name? Seth Speaks, Seth, the woman who had voices she could hear, and so forth. And I don't know, I'm leery of that. I guess I don't know what that puts
Yeah, those
me
are
in terms
sort
of
superstitious, I'd say. I mean, people have different synesthetic experiences, but if we can perceive light, that means that that perceptive ability is eternal, because light is eternal. So we can't...
You got a couple of things you just lacked as internal.
Eternal.
Eternal, I mean, yeah, but a couple of things you linked in with eternal.
So the light and the ability to perceive light.
Some pretty big
light.
Ideas are eternal. I don't know, Fuller, is the youth aware of Fuller, Buckminster Fuller?
Yeah, I think his legacy is very much alive with a lot of youth. Yeah.
It is, really? Okay, that's good. He's a pretty good... it was Jane Roberts was one. And she had a voice that she could come... The thing would come through her at another level. And I was actually with her when she did that one time. She went into a state. Edgar Cayce. And there are people who've been seeing these kind of things that I tend to have a jaundiced eye toward.
And that's
I'm older.
I think we're looking at this from a different perspective.
Probably,
And certainly, you know, there are plenty of
charlatans.
Of spiritualists.
Yeah.
Yes, charlatans, and some maybe not charlatans, but I think the fundamental of being what
reason.
Spirit is, and the early traditions. I know for Ted, Ted is very very committed to, you know, his relationship with the First Nations and traditions there, and is very committed to the principles of Baha'i. For me, Taoism, a philosophy that is 3,000 years old, is deeply in tune with certain aspects of the universe that we're now finding in quantum physics. We're finding that the I Ching, the math behind the I Ching, is identical to DNA. Mm-hmm. In Egypt, Hermes Trismegistus, three times greatest Hermes, who is really the foundation of all Western philosophy. If you look at what Hermes was saying, once again, it's as above, so below. In Hermetism, that all is mind, all is consciousness, was fundamental. Mm-hmm. So if you're looking at what I consider the authentic spiritual traditions that go back to our earlier times, that go back to the indigenous, you can see pretty much across the board that many of these groups just, through their intuition, through their unpolluted lives, saw certain fundamentals of the universe that have become disassociated from us.
But we keep learning more.
Yeah.
And they played hell on Galileo. Hieronymus Bosch paintings. You see Hieronymus Bosch when he found after the lenses were developed, because they didn't have the material capability of examining except with mystery and things like that. There must have been a lot of tales going on in Cro-Magnon caves and things like that to understand things and everything. But when he discovered the telescope and made it possible to observe the orbit pathways of Jupiter with that, he was able to discern that this Earth that everyone had a sense of identity with and everything, it was not, as they all felt,
as perception
the center
tells
of the universe.
Us.
No, the center of the universe and of everything. And they had all kinds of principles built on that were bullshit, to use an overlooked term. And they put him in jail for bringing up something that was counter to what the population at large had a sense of identity wrapped up in.
Absolutely.
And that's a thing that probably has resonance today.
Today, yeah.
Although ironically, now we've rediscovered that we are the center of the universe. So I think there's a certain ironic element about that, is that now we know that the universe is essentially a hypersphere. And a hypersphere...
What's a hypersphere? I don't
know
the
term. Well, a hypersphere is a sphere in which every aspect of the sphere is the center. So that...
Could you spell that out a little bit, Doctor? Every
aspect of the sphere is the center.
The sphere or the sphere?
The sphere.
Sphere.
Right. That the universe, my universe, extends outward from me in all directions. So I am the center of my universe. Your universe extends outward from you in all directions. Each one of us, no matter where you are, you're in the center of the universe.
Well, I can't understand that, to tell you the truth. I just can't understand.
There's a
that.
Beautiful,
I've never
roomy
been spiritually
one.
Inclined. I tend to distrust it.
There's, I think, in the Baha'i, there's a tradition that whatever reason finds spirit and religion must submit to it. So they have to be in. They're actually one system, and it's reason. So science is the outer application of reason. And religion or spirit is really the taxonomy of how we understand the internal experience.
Yeah.
There's a beautiful writing of Rumi that says, "Dost thou consider thyself a puny form when within thee the universe is folded?" Uh-huh. And so there's another very fascinating proof about maybe the divine that's in those writings of that if we put together all the minds of the universe, every single mind in the infinite universe, that all of their experience of the divine could not come close to understanding the divine. So that is how...
That's a conundrum.
It's a conundrum, but there's another proof that whatever is the cause of something cannot lack its powers. So the light that comes from a candle, the flame cannot lack the powers of the light it sheds. That's and the same with the sun. So the sun's rays are not the sun, but it comes from the sun. So we're aware, so we come from awareness.
Yeah.
So the untainted awareness, or the origin of awareness, is fundamental to aligning ourselves to our each other and the world. And I think that there, hopefully at some point, science, especially the social science, which was my background, which comes into how do we organize society, will not ignore the great teachers, you know, like Christ and Muhammad and Moses and Buddha. These are, they're humans. So could they lack understanding of the nature of reality?
I do distrust the religious traditions, you know, just because I think it was a way of having a sense of identity, which is important in terms of the history of the product. Fuller used to talk about the universe and our role in it and everything, and he said that he said the human experience in evolutionary terms was like a countervailing a development of he used to use the term synergy, the behavior systems unpredicted by the parts, some of the parts resonancy perhaps. And he said that there was the second law of thermodynamics is that all systems move toward chaos, to the limits of the system. And he was thinking that the evolutionary, or proposing the evolutionary process was an anti-entropic function in universe that was emerging out of the context itself. But it had an anti-entropic function, the evolutionary process. I like to see things in that term, that we're part of an evolutionary process that can be understood scientifically, and that most of the things that came out of the past were based on ignorance.
I agree fully, and I think, you know, we're hitting all kinds of different points. We're jumping around.
I know.
And part of that is that we're informed by integral philosophy. And we were talking about Ken Wilber's work. And an integral lifestyle, it's called equal. All quadrants, all lines, all states. And that an integral lifestyle, based on, you know, what Ken Wilber, who developed the system, requires a spiritual foundation to understand the universe and to grow from. So that's an inherent part of integral. The type of spirituality is in no way defined. And I think from integral we make a very strong distinction between religion and spirituality.
Or dogma and flow.
Yeah.
Just to make it more extreme.
And that religion and dogma have truly been used throughout time to control populations. But the fact that in the scientific view, does not answer the question. The scientific view still needs a miracle in it. You know, the scientific view is saying, give us one free miracle, let the Big Bang happen out of nothing, and
well,
then
it
we're
may be
good from there on.
No, it may well be.
Totally.
It may well be
right.
We're at a
Let's
time.
Get everything from nothing and base it on that.
that would be one way to go at it. But we're coming to a time, I think, not on a spiritual plane. Well, maybe it's nothing is absolute. I mean, that's sort of you don't believe in absolutes and everything like that. But that there's a synergy to existence. Behavior of systems unpredicted by the sum, something more than the sum of integrated systems. And there's something more. And if we could just talk about the human condition, now that's what we're supposed to be talking about. I tend to see it in materialistic terms. And that, you know, we have a measurement of consciousness that becomes part of an evolutionary process. And I guess we apex that in terms of what's going on. But what we have is a system where the individual expressions that have been able to become part of the mix, as it were. Think like a jam session with musicians or something. And You've got the people, you got all the population of the world coming. Then there's a material world in which they interrelate with one another, and that material world facilitates or obviates or doesn't allow or cuts off because of often spiritual projections of a certain kind of political stance that a religious person or a religious movement can take, and all of that sort of thing. But what happens if you take the whole of human society, we may be coming to a time where they've been so mired, the historical process, the human consciousness and understanding and intelligence has been so mired in all of the chains of ignorance. Mm-hmm. We're coming out of ignorance and we're growing in our knowledge, and we're also growing in our ability to integrate within a larger system of people, like a jam session, to where we may get to the point where this thing that's going on, perhaps it can be proposed, Fuller did, and some others, that we're coming to a point where there will be a liberation of the human consciousness that has never been, and will be coming out of the collective agreement on how we're going to make it, that each part of the collective consciousness is called the Homo sapiens species. Take it species wide, Lovelock, Gaia, something. There will reach a point where they will be able to be maximizing their participation in an anti-entropic function of understanding the universe in a jam session sense. They'll reach a certain peak, and let's say liberation, and let's say just material liberation. People, by and large, are slaves to the system of political oppression that's been characteristic of the whole of the Homo sapiens species. Religious ideas have been used to enslave them often, one group to another. They fight and kill each other over principles of that, over material things and everything. But we may be coming to a time when there will be a liberation of the entire Homo sapien exercise or species. And that there would be like a resonancy or a synergistic relationship to the universe at a level transcendent to what we have not ever been. It's like the new punctuated equilibrium coming out of evolution. And we will not know what that is. It's like speciation. We're coming to not a political change. It's something coming out of evolutionary change. We cannot know what that is until we get there. It's synergy. It's synergetic. But what it requires is a liberation of every cell in a human, 100 trillion cells in a human organism. Yeah. Each one is important. Each has their own individual identity. They all work as a system. And if it's healthy, they work well. So if we get that on a planetary basis, which we have the capability perhaps of coming to in your generation or even sooner maybe, that we may be at a time of qualitative, not quantitative transformation of the human condition, qualitative, almost onto punctuated equilibrium, a new way of being in universe. And we cannot know that till we get there out of a collective fulfilling of the maximum participation of each part of the Homo sapiens species writ large.
And it won't stop either.
So that's
after
not
that.
Just another little change of political party or spiritual tradition or whatever, you know. I don't know if it's possible that we could be at a time punctuated, like Stephen Jay Gould, Eldridge, a punctuated equilibrium in an evolutionary
what
sense.
We are very
or
much.
Is that just stupid? Is that just a crazy fantasy to be thinking we could be leaving at a time, not a little political change like the French Revolution or the American Revolution, but a qualitative transformation like punctuated equilibrium,
absolutely,
a new species appearing?
I think that it's
or relating to.
I think with the
realistically and materially.
I think with the amendment of really the moral foundation of development.
Yeah, that's part of it, yeah.
And that's the trick, though, is that comes from that it's not an ideological process, but it's a very spiritual process that the great teachers had perverted after their ascension, you know. Christ's, like somebody said, Christ was the last Christian. right? Died and let die. Yeah. So there was, yeah. And I mean Christ's impact in the world. I mean, he brought together the Assyrians, the Syrians, the Jewish people, like welded together entire nations. So well, the impact in his life, you know, within hundreds of years of his, and his teachings were the generating force of that. And it's similar with the Tao Te Ching. What would China look like without that? What would Asia look like without that? Yeah. Or without the Buddhist teachings? These are we can't advance as a whole and divorce ourselves of this element of our evolution either. And it's not to cast them away, but in Baha'i teachings, we have to throw away religion if it's causing destruction, because it's supposed to be a cause of union, of genuine union.
Yeah.
The whole point, the word religion means like to
grasp, to hold, you know, to hold, literally.
Yeah. Yeah. So like you think of the whole body of humanity, that's the same word. What you just said, like this attenuated punctuation,
that's a different experience of that word.
That's
coming out of a secular view, for whatever you want to call it, of understanding things in a materialistic way. I guess that's what I think.
But they're not exclusive.
They
don't have to exclude each other, and that's sort of where hyper-unity, I'd say, where enough.
What's hyper-unity? I mean, unity of the whole of the human species or something like that? That's
what I was
saying. Like a gigantic jam session.
It has to. That's our necessary step right now.
Or something.
But I think that we would see that a lot of people who come from these spiritual or religious traditions, that there is something that we can't ignore that mystery of the universe in that process and say, oh, we all did it ourselves. That's sort of, it's kind of like the guy who's messing up the jam session is saying, it's me doing it all, you know, that would be.
Yeah, well, that would be. No, but if you're in a jam, you do music, I guess, though. I don't know if you do. Anyway, you're doing a jam session, you guys are jamming, or gals, and whatever. If you're, and you're going, and it's going, toot, 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 you know, everybody's going, toot, toot, everybody's into the drums, and oh, it's great, man. It's you, toot, toot, toot. And then everybody's going, toot, toot, this is groovy, groot, groot, groot. And then one of the guys goes, toot, toot, toot. And then they toot, and then they want to go toot, 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 and you get to a new thing.
Yeah.
You get something new moving out of that jamming session, that spiritual, that synergistic resonancy of a liberated humanity.
Yeah.
This humanity is on the verge of liberation from a historical context of oppression, and I think that that's something that is not taken account of. We think we're all still living in another era of Bojest or something.
Well, I think Eckhart Tolle kind of sets it up in his book, The New Earth. And he says that, you know, millions of years ago, flowers hadn't evolved yet. And that on Earth, every once in a while, there would be a flower. Yeah. You know, some bizarre plant would throw out a flower. And then suddenly, all of the plants decided there would be flowers, and that there was an occurrence of flowers on Earth. And that if we look at
that could be understood materialistically, evolutionarily,
and if we look at
spirit.
If we look at spiritual masters, as Ted was saying, you know, Christ, Muhammad, Buddha, these were flowers in humanity.
Okay.
Every once in a while, a person would be born who was truly more advanced than others. The problem was that there wasn't good record keeping, so somebody would come
true.
Up,
totally.
They would be
born. They didn't have a laptop, you know, much less a CDV.
And the folks around them would pick up on it for a while and be authentic, and then over time, the dominators and the exploiters would come in and utilize that.
Yeah, more or less.
Now we're at a time where there's a flowering of flowers. There are suddenly a lot of flowers.
There's a lot of flowers that aren't coming out of the bad side of things, or the bad side of interpretations.
There's always been bad side, but what's key here now is that there's videotape. So, like, if Jesus showed up now,
they're called files now. There is no videotape anymore.
Files. There's records.
Things were moving on, young man.
Right. Yeah. So if Jesus was around now, we'd have images of him, and you don't misinterpret it that easily.
Uh-huh.
So that's
tremendous
tribute shift
to them.
Now.
Yeah, tribute.
The other element, you know, so that's from the human side, and then from the technology side. Bruce Lipton, who is one of the leading cell biologists in the world, has said that, and he's not saying metaphorically, he's saying literally, that the cell membrane is the brain of the cell. That's where it interacts with the world. Information in and out.
Interesting.
And that at the atomic level, that is exactly the same as a computer chip.
Huh.
That at an atomic level, the in-out mechanism in terms of information flow is identical.
Of a cell?
Between a cell and a computer chip.
What kind of a cell? Is that a paramecium cell, or is that a human cell, or what are you talking about?
A cell, a generic.
You want to just leave it that way.
As any type
of. As part of a generic cell.
A cell that has a nucleus.
That covers a lot of territory, but yes.
And that once you come to that understanding, then it's very easy and very clear to see how the internet and computing is literally an organic extension of our evolution.
Well, that is one thing. I want to bring it back, if I can, to the evolution being a thing of, do we agree that it was James Joyce had Daedalus say, "History is a nightmare." History is a nightmare from which I'm attempting to awaken.
Mm.
Now, see, that's something that a lot of people want to see lilacs and things like that in history, and there's spiritual things and everything. But history is something that we're emerging out of,
mm-hmm.
and there's some sort of a context of seeing this transformation in something other than regularly seen terms. You know, that's it. We're coming to the you're talking about this computer and so forth. But is it possible? Look, it's kind of crazy. We're three guys here, and we got Josie Ann here, and a few people, and all that. And there's Mr. Trump, and all the people that are in part of the human scenario, and everything. It's a hell of a show, you know, what's going on, human existence, and all the artifacts that follow, and all the rest of it. But is it possible that we were born after 10,000 generations? We're the 10,000th generation, if we say about 10, 20 years to a generation. And we emerged out of Homo erectus. I thought it was Homo habilis, but apparently it was Homo erectus about 200,000 years ago. And now we come, and that we're at a moment of qualitative, not quantitative, but up that line that's going to back 200,000 years, our line, our genetic line with the rest of the biosphere and everything. At a time of qualitative transformation that encompasses all of that and succeed and is succession to that, do you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
That kind of a change is the time we were born. You could have been born.
Yeah,
into
we
the
could have been born in a horrible time.
And you didn't even have an automobile. You did. I mean, the
it was an okay time then.
Yeah,
but it,
well,
it
had its points.
1700s,
to get the idea that we were born, our generations maybe. We're born into a time of to get the sense of qualitative change, just like we're getting a sense that the development of the robots and so forth now is becoming qualitatively different. It's undercutting the human need to have slaves that you had to have to get production of things that would make the world more comfortable or better for more numbers of people and everything. It doesn't have to have people being wage slaves as they are now. By and large, of the vested interest of the old system, and that's part of the context into which, how did it be that we happened to be born into that? We could have been born in the 3rd century. Or you could have been born in a cave and you have a stick or a rock to hit something or do something. You know, it's so primitive and so backward. To get the sense of the qualitative change, not. That's what I was trying to get at with the idea of a gigantic jam. What metaphor can we use? It's got to be everybody. It's got to be everybody involved in a gigantic, everybody being doing the, representing the best they of their evolutionary capability in it. Do you know what I mean? And like you get 100 trillion cells in a human organism, and every one of them's healthy, and everyone's or I don't know if that's an orgasmin or orgasmin or something like that, but it's a time of qualitative transformation. Do you ever get the sense that that is the case into which we happen to have been born, unlike the rest of humanity going back 10,000 years? Absolutely. Why would it be now? If it is, first of all, is it a possibility that we're coming to the end, a punctuated equilibrium moment where we're going to emerge? And what are the conditions by which that happens in evolution? That'd be worth investigating, wouldn't it? How does the new appear out of the old? What causes that? Have you dealt with that? You did.
Well, it seems as though, Steve, as we were talking about earlier, and Ted referenced Peter Russell.
Okay.
Peter Russell, I believe it was in 86,
yeah,
wrote The Global Brain.
Okay.
And The Global Brain deals with deep evolution, how the universe evolves over time, subatomic particles into atoms, into molecules, and so forth, up a whole line, right?
Uh-huh.
And that everything is a holon, the term holon, H-O-L-O-N.
Yeah, I've seen that term, yeah.
And a holon is a complex adaptive system. It's something that's made up of lots of other things that also has a single identity.
That's like
an elegant system.
Yeah, so elegant, but it's a systems thinking. It's a kind of systems thinking.
And if you look at the world that way, everything in the world is a holon. The world is built on nested hierarchies of holons, and that at this point in time, with the internet, with this organic network that we're extending onto Earth, we are literally, at the very least, creating a global nervous system and potentially a global brain. And as you were saying, not being able to tell what's happening, a law of complex adaptive systems is that once the complexity within the system hits a certain point, it bifurcates. It becomes something new.
Yeah, that's true.
And that you can never predict the outcome of the bifurcation by anything that's come before. It's always
that is synergy. Behavior systems unpredicted by the sum of its parts.
And finally, the other philosopher I'd like to point to is Terence McKenna.
Yeah.
And Terence said the universe likes to create novelty. That's what the universe is up to. It's novelty. All it wants to do is create new things all the time. So there's a certain element to that.
Stop the world, I want to get off, they used to say at times, because there's so much change. But anyway, this is the sort of thing that's going on. Interesting time to have been born into.
And it seems very, like, the global, I think, thought and the fact that we're one being that is expressing its awareness together. The really difficult thing that the scientist, the material scientist, can't get at is a united heart, because any human, I think, understands if your heart is not together.
Are you talking of your heart as an organ that pumps blood, or are you talking as a heart of love and all
the
that?
The heart
kind
of love.
Oh well, that's a whole different thing.
Yeah. And without that, clearly, there's no.
You think, yeah.
And so we can't be in denial of this.
Yeah. In
of
that regard, you could talk when you're talking about this. The other kind of consciousness and everything. What it is largely in terms of the human condition, and I presume, I got a dog. I really love that. I got a cat that is just out of sight, gorgeous, you know, and everything. But I'm going off. It just came to my mind.
Yeah,
it's wonderful.
That's so sweet.
But you're going off into a different territory.
Well, it's
in a way.
There's a writing that
I sort
says
of lost
like
the thought, but what were you talking about?
Well, if we're realizing that part perceptually, we're realizing that I without speaking the we, but really humanity, we're all experiencing this common reality and this bond.
Oh, that's what
And so there's a writing that says, you know, there's no greater distance in the universe than the mind and the heart. And so that gives us an experience of the vastness of our internal reality.
I think the heart is an organ that prints in blood.
But our love in the heart. I mean, our heart is connected at least to the Big Bang. If
I know
you're
it's
a materialist.
There. There's something there called love and everything. But I guess I want to keep things at a material level as much as I possibly can.
The leading science.
Because I'm distrustful of spiritual. Charlotte.
The leading scientists, again, Greg.
Okay, Braden. Yeah. It can become that way.
And Greg,
or anyone, yeah, right.
Greg Braden is an exponent of heart math. And more science is finding that the electromagnetic strength of the heart is something, and I don't know the exact number, something like 100 times greater than the brain, and that the heart truly mediates, and that the heart and that our consciousness is not totally in the brain, but that the heart controls a lot of it. And then if you extend it further to the chakras, the seven chakras, that the heart is essentially the center chakra, which mediates between your lower forces and your higher forces, so that when we think with the heart instead of the brain, we're capable of ingesting information in a totally different way.
You're just amplifying a whole lot of stuff in all that. The heart is something that pumps blood.
But it's also
I'm being very heart love. You're talking about that. I mean, that's a different.
It's
kind
emotions
of thing.
And emotions. We can't divorce. It's good to be dispassionate, to be able to be rational, but if we're one mind, but we don't love each other, how's that mind going to function? So if we in our brain, in our heart, anatomically. Is there's actually a newly discovered artery that goes straight from the heart to the brain. So the heart doesn't just go straight to the lungs.
There's not evidence or anything you're talking about.
This is new.
What are you talking about? A new artery?
An artery that literally the heart is pumping directly to the brain. It's not just going through the vascular system to the brain.
System up in your brain.
But this is brand new. This is only in this last year that a major...
Another new idea!
Or
oh
discovery,
gosh,
I guess.
Coming in droves over the transom. Yeah, yeah.
But this... So our limbic system and our heart and our mind, and they're one thing. They're not, we are a whole thing. And another description of this, of I guess the spirit of a person, is to not just think of the mind as you, but as the phone, you know. You're getting so you are the person who's speaking on a phone, and you're speaking through the medium of the phone. So the brain is receiving signals or is receiving information and giving it to you, who you are, which is not your body and the outer, like the tent veil of your external expression of your exact real self or myself. We can't even know our real, like, present our absolute true self. But that whole being, and which is one with the universe and one with the creation of the universe, is an unbelievably powerful thing.
I don't think we're with them yet. I think we may be coming to be where we're going to be with them, at the universe level, at a level transcendent to what has been the case for 200,000 years of this experiment called humanity. It's coming to like leaving the womb. We've been in the womb of a historical context that is now, we're at the point, we have the
Or what about
it's time. Like a pregnancy doesn't bring birth after 4 months in a person. It's 9. There's a time.
Yeah. And we're experiencing those
Back again
pains.
To my question, how in the hell can it be that you and I and we all three were born, if that's the case, if that's what's before, or maybe that's not, maybe this is just another decade or two in the human history that goes back 10,000 years and you got all kinds of things and all kinds of charlatans, all kinds of fairy tales, all kinds of truths, all of hard won and all that is just part of the historical record. And there's nothing more than that. And we can put it together and everything. But the what's in the offing is a qualitative break with the whole of the history of the species. And then when a species gets to that point, there comes a new species. a new entity in the universe, and it comes out of what was. So we were, and we're becoming something else collectively, and we're at a moment, only moment, when that could possibly be ever happening in 10,000 generations of the existence of our planet, of our species. I mean, that's what's in the offing now, or maybe. Maybe
right,
it
right.
is.
Absolutely.
If we can, and the challenge is there, and it creates tremendous tension and fright even.
We're
it challenges all uses of old institutions
totally.
That had been used to hold the fabric of the society in some sort of semblance of survival and also progression.
Right.
If we view this as a living universe, we're going through a time of metamorphosis. This is a transformation.
It's a easier to understood term.
And
then the transcendence of human.
Well, it's transcendent too, though.
Yeah.
And if you look at actual physical metamorphosis, the way that works is that the caterpillar literally dissolves.
Yeah.
That the cells within the caterpillar suddenly it starts creating what are called imaginal cells.
Is that true?
Yeah, these are completely differentiated from any of the cells that have come before. And the old caterpillar cells start dying off, and the imaginal cells grow. And then suddenly, the old ones are all gone, the new ones are there, and the butterfly is there. So this is.
Are you familiar with how that happens? Those terms are what are used in the literature, the scientific literature?
Yes.
Imaginative cells?
Imaginal.
Imaginal.
Or liminal cells.
Yeah.
There's liminal or the same, imaginal
or
liminal.
Can we compare the difference between some human beings and others? Like, are we going to become a butterfly?
I'd say that if we'd compare, that means that we're part of the old one because we're one.
Mm.
So either we own it or we deny it.
The ultimate unity of it all, you mean.
Yeah, because it's either way, we're one. Rationally, we're one with the future and the past.
Why couldn't we have been born into a year when all you had to do was out and kill a rabbit and eat it over an open fire?
It's always now, Harold.
It's always happening now.
Yeah, it's always now.
Yeah.
Shucks. Well, anyway, it's
just this now. Damn, with Trump.
Yeah.
Well, he can be a cool guy if he wants. He can be cool when he wants.
Well, you
to
might
be
able to see because it gets around a lot of the transformation gets around to things material and things in terms of the political economic system and everything. So we're coming to we're at the end of a first hour of talking. We're going to talk for another hour, okay? If we can fit it in, we don't get. There's a term in New York. Have you heard it yet? 86.
No.
Do you know that term? That means when they throw you out of a saloon at 4 o'clock in the morning. You understand? We don't want to get 86. It's a term.
Right, but what was where it came? Where did it come from?
I don't know where it came from. I don't know where it came from, but it's an accepted term. It means getting thrown out by the backside for being roguish or something like that. But anyway, we're going to come back and do another program, okay, and pick up on this and everything. Your pleasure to have the perception of these two people, two Teds. The Teds have it. And thanks very much for that. And stay tuned. We're
on 86th
Street.
This is
the second program will be carried the next day when this one is carried. I'm not sure when that is. So tune in then, please. And thank you for viewing. And thank you for talking. And let's take a little break and then come back and do another hour.
Great. Thank you, Harold.
Thanks for viewing. And thanks for Rosalie, Josie Ann. I've talked about, our producer who put this all together. Thanks. Okay, now that's it. So that's the program. Put the stamp on
it. We did one.
Nice.
Yeah.
We should walk around.